Okay, we're going to start learning together today. I've asked you all to please, if you can download the material. I sent you in the chat the website to be able to download it. At certain times, we'll actually do a shared screen also. You should be able to download the material. If you have any questions, I'll try to look at the Q&A during this year to try to be able to answer the questions to the best of my ability. Let's begin. So we begin by recognizing the fact that today is Tisha B'Av, and it commemorates the losses and the challenges that have happened to the Jewish people throughout the millennia, not just the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash or the two Batei Mikdash. But it also focuses on the loss and the challenges that have happened to the Jewish people for generations, and the challenges that have happened in society because of the Chorban, because of the destruction. There's a difference between Avelut of an individual and Avelut of a Tzibur, of a community. Avelut of an individual, the intensity of the experience is immediately after the death of a loved one. And therefore, halacha reflects that. The first day of Shiva, and Shiva is much more intense than the subsequent days of 30 days and then a year of mourning if it's for a parent. But when it comes to avelut, when it comes to the mourning for the community over something that happened thousands of years ago or hundreds of years ago or tens of years ago, we start out first with the 3 weeks that has the laws like of the mourning of a year. It's a mourning experience, but not as intense. And then we continue and we focus on the mourning experience of the 9 days, which has the laws of the shloshim, of the 30 days they would have for a private mourner or for an individual mourner. And then we move to Tisha B'Av. Tisha B'Av is like Shiva. We sit on low stools as we're doing now. Our intensity of our mourning experience becomes greater. And so while there is, in the case of mourning for an individual, we decrease the intensity based on the emotional experience. When it comes to mourning for the community, we have to build up to it. And that's what we're doing now. Tisha B'Av actually has really, the day of Tisha B'Av really has 2 days built in it. There is the day of Tisha B'Av until Chatzot. That is the part of Tisha B'Av in which we remove portions of our tefillah. We don't say titkabel tzolason, that God should accept our prayers. We don't say korbanot. We don't recite korbanot. If you're in Israel, which I'm sure most of you are listening to it right now, we don't have the kohanim do birkat kohanim in the morning. Anything that speaks about the connection between God and the Jewish people is almost like severed. In fact, Eicha is about asking the question, Eicha, how could this have happened? So the first half of Tisha B'Av until Chatzot is we challenge the relationship with God. Men don't put on tefillin during the first half of Tisha B'Av. Immediately after Chatzot, then we move to a different paradigm of this Tisha B'Av, one that focuses on renewal and reunion. We put on our tefillin. We include again those paragraphs. Depending what time you recite the mincha prayer, kohanim can do the priestly blessings. And so there is a two-tiered or two paradigms focused on in the Tisha B'Av experience. And these two identities of Tisha B'Av are also highlighted in the keynote. So for example, in the keynote that will be recited, or some will recite this morning, Kinah 21 focuses on the 10 martyrs. And there is a conversation about the 10 martyrs in the Yom Kippur prayer services. But there's a fundamental difference between the two. In the Yom Kippur prayer services, we speak about that we've sinned to God. We want to re-engage in the relationship with God. There is a movement for renewal. But in the Kinah, when we speak about the 10 martyrs, that is totally absent. We don't focus on renewal. We don't focus on what we did wrong. We focus on the extent of the tragedy that during the Hadrianic persecutions, 10 of the major personalities that represent the future and the immortality of the Jewish people were martyred. And I think that that highlights the difference between the first half of Tisha B'Av and the second half of Tisha B'Av. We then continue on, and it's important to recognize the fact, and this we will also see in the keynote, that Eicha is really the first kina. If we look at our sources, you'll see that source number one says that Yirmiyah writes the book of Kinot, which is the book of Eicha. Eicha is the first kina. It is the first time that we ask the question, Eicha, how could this have happened? How could it have happened that the princes and the princesses of the Jewish people, all of the Jewish people, the princes and the prince of God, namely the Jewish people, were destroyed? Eicha, how could this have happened? And so therefore what happens in this conversation of Eicha is a focus on the tragedy. Each parak of Eicha, as we will see in the keynote, because the keynote are just a continuation of Eicha. You'll find the language of Eicha throughout the keynote, because Eicha begins the process. That's why we don't recite Eicha in the morning. It's not like Megillat Esther that we do it both at night and in the morning. Eicha is the beginning of a march of keynote. It began last night and it continues today. Each parak of Eicha focus on a different component of the tragedy. The tragedy is so enormous that the style in which we show how enormous it is if we need to use all of the alphabet, and it's still not enough to marshal an explanation or to share the entire extent of the tragedy. Anytime the Baal HaKinah, the author of HaKinah, uses the entire alphabet, it's to explain the intensity of the tragedy. Before I go on further, I want to just begin with Hakarat HaTov, to Or Torah Stone, that is allowing this to happen. I want to thank Matthew Miller from Koren, who allowed me to photocopy some of the keynote in the handouts. We asked permission, and he was immediately responsive in the positive. I thank Koren and Matthew Miller for that. I also want to thank Rabbi Soloveitchik Zatzal, for Rabbi Soloveitchik for many years explained the keynote. And everything that I'm going to say, or almost everything I'm going to say, not the archaeology, but the other parts, come from conversations and shiurim of Rabbi Soloveitchik. And perhaps the person who, may he continue to live a very long life, who has carried on the tradition of Rabbi Soloveitchik and done it so effectively, is Rabbi Dr. Jacob J. Schachter. And the Torah that I'm going to share is not just Torah that I heard from Rabbi Soloveitchik, but also Torah that I heard and was shared with me by my friend, my colleague, my mentor, Rabbi Dr. Jacob J. Schachter. And so let's continue on. Eicha. As I mentioned, Eicha focuses on the different components of the tragedy. But Rabbi Soloveitchik highlighted that the third parak of Eicha isn't 22 verses corresponding to every letter of the alphabet, but it's 66 verses. It's threefold. It follows the alphabet, 3 in Aleph, 3 in Bet, 3 in Gimel, etc., etc., etc. But Rabbi Soloveitchik wanted to explain why is it that the third parak, for lack of a better analogy, the cream in the Eicha Oreo cookie, why is that in threefold? And Rabbi Soloveitchik explained that sometimes when we speak about tragedy, when we speak about large numbers, millions of people, it's almost easier to digest than when we speak about the loss of an individual. And Eicha, the third parak, is not focusing like the other parakim are, like the other chapters are, on the enormity of the challenge. It's not focusing on what happens to the land of Israel. It's not focusing on what happens to the entire leadership. It's not focusing on what happens to the mothers of Israel. It's focusing on one person. Ani hagever ra'ani. I am the individual. And therefore, it's important to recognize in tragedy, in order to really experience, sometimes you don't focus on the millions or the tens of thousands or the thousands. You focus on the one individual. We can talk about the COVID-19 challenges. We could talk about it in massive numbers and the hundreds of thousands that have been affected. But sometimes it's much more effective to focus on the loss that happened in one family, the one individual. Ani hagever ra'a ani, the third perek of Eicha, the middle perek, focuses on the loss of the individual, because when we speak about community tragedy, we can't forget that at the root of community tragedy is what happens to the individual. Ani hagever ra'ani. And therefore, if you went someplace last night to hear, or if you heard Eicha on Zoom, you might have heard with a proper reading that the third chapter is even read differently. It has a different tone and cadence to it, because we wanted to accentuate this point that the need or the tragedy of the individual is critically important when we talk about the tragedy of millions or of hundreds of thousands. And finally, the final parak of Eicha has 22 verses in it, but it is not in alphabetical order. And the reason for that is that it's not in alphabetical order because it's speaking about the survivor. And the survivor never is able to organize his or her life with perfect cadence, as is celebrated or symbolized by having a perek in full order, in alphabet order. And therefore, the final paragraph, the final perek, the final chapter, focuses on the survivor, but has the 22 verses, but not in alphabetical order. And we all know that. In fact, survivors are talking about that during this time in which they've had to be quarantined, that they are tragically reliving the nightmares of the Holocaust, because it just reminds them it's a much different situation, thank God. We're in a much better position. The tragedy is nowhere near the same, but it just reminds them of that. Someone who is a survivor never is able to fully get back their life in a perfect organized structure. And indeed, let's go on a little bit further about Eicha, because all of these comments really are seen throughout all of the keynote. Rabbi Soloveitchik told us, if you ever want to understand in Hebrew what a word really means, you have to look at the first time it's used in Tanakh. And the first time that Eicha is used in Tanakh is when it is used in Sefer Bereshit, when it's used and it means Ayeka, where are you? If you look at source 2, it's where after Adam and Chava sin and God is looking for them, Perek Gimel, Pasuk Tes, Vayikra Hashem Elokim El Adam, and God calls to Adam. And notice first the language here, Hashem Elokim. Hashem represents the God of intimacy. Elohim is the God of power. It's the God of intimacy, the God still of power, that wishes to have a relationship with God, with humankind, that calls to him and calls to Chava, Vayomer lo, and says, Ayeka, where are you? Rabbi Soloveitchik explained, if you truly want to understand the message of Eicha, of how could this have happened? How could the Jewish people, how could the world community suffer the way it suffered with all the diasporas? The answer is, Ayeka, where are we? Each one of us can bring the redemption. We each have to add our own stone to the rebuilding of the Beit HaMikdash. We do that when we answer the question, Ayeka, what type of lives do we live? How do we organize our lives? How do we make sure that our lives are purposeful? Ayeka, where are we? The answer to the question of Eicha, how could this have happened, is how the first time that word is used in Tanakh, Ayeka. Rabbi Soloveitchik also reminds us that the Hebrew word gola, diaspora, and geula, which is seen in source 3. Again, I urge you all to go onto the chat and you'll see where I have shared with you how you can simply click on that link and download the sources. And Rabbi Soloveitchik explained the difference between the Hebrew word gola, gimel vav lamed hey, and geula, redemption, gimel aleph vav lamed hey. It's the exact same word. The only difference is the letter aleph for ani, myself. Where am I in the process? You want to know the difference between exile and redemption? Know where the difference is between where the person is. When the person is involved in ayeka, in being able to change the world and make a difference, we move from a state of exile, of personal exile, of communal exile, to a state of geula, to a state of redemption. And before we begin our first kina, Rabbi Soloveitchik also shared with us, and I can't do this justice, but he highlighted the fact that the cantillations, the truck for Esther, Megillat Esther, where humankind makes the difference, where Mordechai and Esther, representing humankind, make the difference, that they're able to... So someone just said they can't see the text. So if you go to the if you go to the chat, you'll see the text, and I will actually also send you a copy of that. I'll send you right now a copy of that, so you can just download it. If you can't download it, in a, shortly I will also put it on the screen. But for right now, we don't need it. Rabbi Soloveitchik explained, you know why the trup, the cantillations for Megillat Esther and Eicha are exactly the same? They're exactly the same because the difference between the story of Esther, where human initiative makes a difference, and the trials and tribulations of Tisha B'Av is our voice. If you look at the chat, the chat says, where the downloads are, I will send it again. I just sent it a second time. So again, as Rabbi Soloveitchik explained, Eicha and Esther are exactly the same because they highlight the responsibility for us. We make the difference whether it's Eicha or whether it's Esther. We do all the difference. We make sure whether it's Gola or Geula. Okay, we're going to start with the first kina. I'm going to share the screen now and show you some of this. You should be able to see it now. The source number one is what I shared with you earlier. Source number two is about the Ayeka. And Shavasuru, that's the kina we're going to recite now. And as we recite this kina, or right before we recite this kina, I want to point out a few pieces to you. First of all, as I said earlier, as we recite this kina of Shavasuru, you're going to see in this kina, you're going to hear the words of Eicha. You're going to hear language of Eicha that you'll remember. And the first paragraph of Shavasuru speaks about the machitza, the chasm between the Beit HaMikdash in the heavens and the destructive Beit HaMikdash, the destroyed Beit HaMikdash on earth. But there's also still within the kina, there is still sometimes a highlighting of also the recognition of the of redemption. So in the second paragraph of the kina, you'll see, I'll point it out to you, hold on. It says, Eini chita l'chazon ben Berchia. My eyes, the author of this kina, Rabbi Elezer HaKalir, says, my eyes are waiting for the chazon of Ben Berechia. My eyes are waiting for the redemption of, or the redemptive comments of Ben Berechia. That is predicated on a Gemara. The Gemara at the end of Makot tells us that Rabbi Akiva and, as it says, where my cursor is, Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Yeshua, Rabbi Elezer, or Rabbi Elezer ben Azariah, and Rabbi Gamaliel are walking on the way, and it continues, and it says that they come to the Beit HaMikdash, Kivan she'egiu l'harabayit, they come to the harabayit, Ra'u shu'ul she'yotza mi Beit Kodesh Kedashin, they see a fox running out of the Holy of Holies, Itchilu hein bochim. They begin to cry, all the rabbis, except for Rabbi Akiva, that he begins to laugh. Amrulo, they said to him, b'nei ma'atam tzachik, how can you be laughing? Amr lahem, Rabbi Akiva said to them, b'nei atem bochim, why are you crying? Amrulo, they said to him, of course we're crying. A place, the Holy of Holies, where an individual, even a Kohen, could not enter except once a year. Now there are foxes. It's so desolate that foxes are there. Shu'alim ho'chubo v'lo nivche, and we're not crying. Amar lahem, Rabbi Akiva says, l'kach, that's why anim tzachek, that's why I'm laughing. Because in Yeshayahu, in Isaiah, it says, idali edin ne'manim, I'm going to have two witnesses regarding what's going to happen to the Jewish people. Et Uriah ha'kohen ve'et Zechariah. Uriah the Kohen and Zechariah. And Rabbi Akiva says, the chima'inyan Uriah eitzel Zechariah, what's the connection between Uriah and Zechariah? Uriah lived in the first Beit HaMikdash. Zechariah lived in the second Beit HaMikdash. But he says, Rabbi Akiva, now I understand. I understand because the prophecy of Uriah is, l'chein b'glauchem tzion sadet techaresh, that Zion will be plowed as a field. And I wasn't sure if I would ever see that happen, which I've just highlighted that piece. But now that I've seen that happen, I know the second part of the verse will also come true. What's the second part of the verse? That Zechariah's prophecy will come true. What's Zechariah's prophecy? Zechariah's prophecy is, Od Yeshvu Zekenim Zekenot Berchovot Yerushalayim, that there will be the elderly will walk through the streets of Jerusalem. Achelo Neskaima, until I saw with my own eyes that the prophecy of Uriah had come true, that Zion was being plowed as a field, I was afraid that maybe the prophecy of redemption of Zechariah would not come true. But now that I've seen that the prophecy of Uriah has come true, that the Holy of Holies, there are literally foxes that enter and exit there, I now know that the prophecy of Zechariah will also come true. And the rabbis at that point respond, Akiva nechamtanu, Akiva nechamtanu, Akiva, you have comforted us. Akiva, you have comforted us. This is what the Kina is speaking about when it says, Eini chita l'chazon b'berchia, my eyes are waiting for the second piece to come true, that there will be redemption, something that we have seen and in so many ways in our period of time. By the way, although this is not our focus, I just want to point out the sixth source, and that is the story that we all remember from the Haggadah, Maisa b'Rabbi Leza, Rabbi Yeshua, Rabbi Leza ben Azariah, Rabbi Akiva, Rabbi Tarfon. There's a story about all of these great rabbis coming to Bnei Brak, which is where Rabbi Akiva lives, and having the Pesach Seder together. If you've ever asked yourself the question, why particularly these rabbis, which by the way, Rabbi Akiva is the youngest in the group. Normally the youngest one goes to the elderly, the oldest one, not vice versa. I believe the idea here is that Rabbi Akiva, Pesach is about redemption. Rabbi Akiva's whole Weltanschauung is about redemption. He's the teacher of Bar Kochba. He focuses on the whole notion of redemption. These rabbis who meet Rabbi Akiva at the Temple Mount, or next to the Temple Mount, the Mount Scopus, and can't see redemption when the foxes are walking through the Holy of Holies. They can't see the larger picture. These who cannot see the larger picture need to be schooled by Rabbi Akiva in his home on the night of redemption, on Pesach night, to be explained to them what exactly redemption is all about. Rabbi Akiva, during the darkest times of the Jewish people, before the destruction of the Second Commonwealth in 7 CE, is teaching them about the larger narrative of redemption. By the way, Rabbi Akiva lives in Bnei Brak. The word Brak means the beginning of light. The beginning of the sunrise. Ad shabo tamidehem va'amru lehem rabotenu, until the students understood the message, and that is the message of Kriyat Shema Shel Shacharis. This is what Rabbi Akiva is talking about. This is what the Baal HaKina, Rabbi Lezer Kali, was talking about. So why don't we start reading this Kina together? We'll say it to ourselves. At certain points, I'll pause and highlight some additional pieces, and then we'll move on. Shavasu Rimimani, Shimuni Ochrai, Sachiyamo, Sazimuni, Betre Chavarai, Sakosa Mishkan Mishkosti Varai, Sakosa Vuglu Giborai, Sakukaf Madai Varai, Kasila Kohabirai, Naflu Odeinu Butsuduhuya. She's fallen to the depth, and there she remains. But Aini, my eyes wait for the prophecy to come true of Chazon ben Berechia, the prophecy of Zechariahu, what we just talked about, that Od Yishvu Zekeinim Zekeinot Berechovot Yerushalayim, something that we, thank God, in our generation have merited to see. Al Pilei Gilal Gilach Abuya, people we can read on our own. It goes on further. Alpanei Paras Nivutu Chazideha Pagesuf Zachrak Arug Sodeha Tachal Chit Shilo Takaf Sodeha Patsu Chazireyar Aye Chazideha Patsu Maser Valinideha Pershat Siyam Biodeha Alhar Shadu Zonei Mizanai Safu Arushi Zedonai Samtu Benov Lamod Zedonai So Natsrat Lorer Midanai Tzakami Bimei Ben Dinai Tzadik Adonai. The Kina continues. Atakalim Hichbadita. You lifted up the lowly Babylon who stripped us of our glory. And it goes on to speak about the idea of Karati Lioshvei Givon. I called to my allies. I called to my colleagues. Ho Od Ein Zerumumu, but they have ignored me. Rabbi Soloveitchik would speak about, he was not a political person, but he would speak about the fact that the United Nations, that maybe the only redemptive moment of the United Nations is when they declared the State of Israel. That every time Israel needs to go in front of them, with the exception of the United States and maybe a few others, our allies totally ignore us. He spoke about how in the wars, like for example, Yom Kippur, how so many countries, Western countries, refused to allow America to even send its aid to protect Israel over its airspace. Karati lema'avai, I've called to my friends, those who I thought were my friends, but hema rimuni, they have fooled me. Lama ruach apenu l'tevach shamru, re'iti ki tanu arenu kamaru, re'ita ki amabachaz b'ulecha kamaru, rafta b'yad t'cheskum gom k'mo maru, re'i v'nachi demek ayamru, Again, these are words from Echa. Hashiveni sisi shima l'goy seini. Shiftam remos chetze rai. Again, wrote words from Echa l'adgeni. Siftei mishurim divirat amalini. Shmatim remos marim amalini. Shmatim chatzav amalini. Shemu ki nechna ani. Ki tam chakta b'keis ofanecha. Here, as Rabbi Lezer HaKalir comes to the end of his kina, he again brings in a little bit of redemption. Kitam chakta b'keis ofanecha. What does that mean? Kitam chakta b'keis ofanecha. What it means is, as you see in the English, that the image of Jacob, who's known as Yaakov Ishtam, is found in the Kisei HaKavod, in the holy throne of God, the heavenly throne of God. Why is that important? That's important because what the Baal HaKina is saying, that God, even though there's a chasm between us now, I know, I'm confident that there will be a romantic renewal between us, because you sit in a chair in which the image of Yaakov is found in that chair. And therefore, every single day and every single night, God, you are confronted with our patriarch. We are known as Bnei Yisrael, the children of Jacob. You see that every single day, and therefore, kitam chakta b'keis ofanecha, because you see that every single day, I'm confident, teshuv lahem gemul, that you will return us, ka'az chazot panecha, as in the past. I'm confident about that, and that's what source 7 says. It's the Yalkut Shmoni that speaks about the fact that when the angels were going up and down, when Jacob was in the dream, they saw Jacob's image on the floor of, you know, where he was resting. But then when they went up to heavens, They saw his image in both places. They saw his image upstairs in the heavens, and they saw his image where he was laying on the ground. Zachenu bachur betula kivalanu raha bednam chakulanu zachar denai mehayalanu. This highlighting of the fact that there is always some sign of redemption, even though we're at the stage of pre-chatzot, before the half a day, there is this recognition that we even speak about redemption. And by the way, this hope of redemption is actually found on graffiti that is found on the stones actually of the Kotel. I share with you, in front of you, a stone, which we'll look at in a little bit more depth in a moment, but this stone is a stone from the Kotel. And if you really look carefully at the stones of the Kotel, you'll see that a few of them, not all of them, not even many of them, a few of them have written words in them that someone wrote in. And just to point out exactly where this is, if you ever walk by as you're entering in to the, if you walk by where the entrance is from the bus stop or from where the taxis take you, you will actually, and you're about to go into security there, you'll see, if you look over to your right side, that you see the Davidson Center and all of the archaeological finds from there. You'll see a sign. You'll see this sign. I took a picture of it. You'll see this sign and above it. So it's pretty high up. So it wasn't written now. It's not at top of the Kotel. So it was written probably in the time of the Middle Ages when the ground was at that stage. And there's a statement there. What is that statement? And we'll look at it again on the rock. Uri'item v'sas libchem v'atzmoseichem k'desha tifrachna. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. Your limbs shall flourish like grass. Those that's written there. Again, I show you this, I'll enlarge it. But you can see a little bit of it. Uri'ita k'sos libchem. That's what you can see. That's what's written there. There was this always this optimism that the Jewish people had. The Napoleon once said, the fact that the Jewish people can still cry for the temple so many hundreds and thousands of years later is just proof that their optimism and their focus will help ensure that the temple and all that that represents is rebuilt. And that's what we see here. And that's what we see in the archaeology. Again, if you walk by the Kotel, you'll see that. Okay. We're going to move to the next one of our, keynote. If anyone has any questions, again, you can feel free to ask it in the Q&A. We'll move further now. In the next, you see the following. I want to focus on the kina that is, hold on. I want to focus on the kina that focused, that it's kina number, Kina number 10, it's a kina that focuses on what happened to the priest, what happened to the Kohanim. I'm having a little computer challenge here. I'm going to just, you'll see the sources will escape the screen for just a moment, but we'll continue to go on. This kina focuses on the, I'm just going to bring up that again. One moment. please. Okay, now ready again. This kinah, like Echa, focuses on the recognition of the loss of leadership. In particular here, we're focusing on the loss of the Kohanim. Source number 10, which is in front of you, is from the Gemara in Tanit. It speaks about the fact that there were 24 mishmarot. There were 24 groups of Kohanim that split 2.5 weeks in service in the temple itself. The rest of the time, they served as the teacher of the Jewish people, Kohanim and Levi'im. And each one would go up for 2.5 weeks. And this kinah, also written by Rabbi Elazar Kalir, is written in 24 paragraphs. Every one of the paragraphs focuses on one of the mishmarot, one of the groups of Kohanim. So if we look at this kinah, which is found in our handout, it's, 1 second. Source 14, Echa Yashvach HaBesel HaSharon. You'll see that this kinah, 24, it uses alphabet, similar to Echa, 24 paragraphs, every one ends with one of the mishmarot, one of the stations. So for example, Maron, the last word of the first paragraph, Tzipori, the Kohanim from Tzipori or Tziporim, the Kohanim from Ayatalo, the Kohanim from Mi Beit Lechem. And before we recite this kinah, I want to point out from the handouts that I'm sharing with you a few important things. The first is the fact that the kinah, the keynotes speak about every city of Kohanim. It's interesting that the Times of Israel, a number of years ago, had a story about the caves of Arbel, one of the cities of the Kohanim up north. And it speaks about the cave dwellers, the people who live there. And it doesn't explain it, but it says, I highlighted for you, Arbel's cave dwellers built rituals, baths, and water cisterns and enlarged the caves in order to make their homes more comfortable. It doesn't actually explain why they had rituals, baths in there. We now understand it by looking at this kinah, because this was a city of Kohanim. A city of Kohanim needs, if they're going to eat Trumot HaMasrot, they need to have access to a mikvah. So they built mikvos in their caves, in their large caves, in their ornate caves, so that when they were able to eat Trumot HaMasrot, they could immediately go to their own personal mikvah. The other thing that's going to be mentioned here is Yodafat. The kinah, which we're going to look at right now. Sorry, going a little too fast here. Moving. Screen's moving too fast. We'll get to it in a second. The kinah here, Echa Yashvach HaTzev LaSharon, mentions, speaking on the Kohanim. So, why don't we're going to read it together, or we'll say it, and then I'm going to stop in different places at it. Echa Yashvach HaTzev LaSharon. How the rose of Sharon is now sitting alone. The Daman Romi Pinoseon, what's happened to the people who were saying the song of the Kohanim? The Na'u Mishmarotam Kohanim, B'nei Aron, Kinisbar Habayit, B'misrei Marom, when the temple was destroyed, what happened to the leadership. It goes on. This nilkadu yodafat is critically important. What is that? Nilkadu yodafat is highlighting what happens up north, and that is that up north. I'm going to stop the share for a second to explain this. What happens up north is that the people living up north realize Yodafat is up north, that they're protecting Jerusalem, that when the Romans are besieging Israel, their protection of the north stops Jerusalem from being sieged. And therefore, actually, there are coins that were found, not too many, very rare coins that were found, that from this time of the destruction of the temple, coins that were minted that say that we're doing this lema'an Yerushalayim, for the sake of Jerusalem. Now, Yodafat is particularly an important location because Yodafat is actually the place where the Kohen that is in charge of the fortresses there is none other than Josephus. And Josephus actually convinces his colleagues to basically kill themselves, with Josephus saying that he will be the last one to kill himself. And what he does is he surrenders to the Romans. So first I want to highlight to you the coin that I mentioned to you. The coins minted in the north, this one particularly in Gamla. This is the coin, and it says, for the redemption of Jerusalem. And no doubt these coins were produced during the siege or immediately preceding the siege. But it makes a political statement that no matter what was going on with the Romans, the Jews were trying to keep on their everyday life. And when we speak about Josephus Flavius, again, this is not the time to go through Josephus. But if you look where I've highlighted here, the cities which Josephus claimed to have fortified were isolated from one another and could only defend themselves singly without any cohesion or plan. The decisive battle took place around the city of Yodafat, to which Josephus had retired and which resisted for 6 weeks. When the city fell on the first of Tammuz, Josephus fled with 40 men to a cave. They each resolved to slay his neighbor rather than to be taken captive. This is a similar motif that you see also in Masada. Josephus artfully cast the lots, deceitfully managing to be one of the last two men left alive, and then persuaded his companion to go out with him and surrender to the Romans. Eventually, he becomes the Roman Jew and records the history of what happens. But Josephus is the Kohen who's in charge of all of this. So let's go back to our Kina here. We were in the middle of the Kina. Kipashu b'lechem upat nilkata Yodafat. It speaks about how Yodafat was captured. And the other ones, it doesn't speak about how they were captured, because obviously, any city is captured is tragic. But in this case, the capturing of Yodafat is really the beginning of the end. We mark the beginning of the end with the 3 weeks, the breaking of the walls of Jerusalem, and the fact that it took 3 weeks for the starving people inside, a walk that's not more than 10 minutes, to get to the temple. But the real beginning started with the destruction or the breaking of the fortresses or the surrendering by Josephus. Zachra Zman Asher Nase Benishma Yeshivu Vata Nodamein Lovu Anava Roshavu Varevu Uksulu Koneyalu Chet Chatav Amru Lil Zel We continue on with the paragraph. Please feel free to say it to yourself. Again, you understand the archaeology. You now understand the language here. A cloud of dust at his feet, like a mourner, no longer clothed in priestly garments, were the priests of the watch of Arbel. Arbel is speaked about in the positive sense, and particularly because they were machbid, even they were careful, even on Trumot and Masrot and Tumah v'Tahara, as I shared with you in that source. That's what the Kohanim are all about. They're focused even in times of tragedy. Yado parasor b'beit zvul, the enemy stretches hand against the temple. Ki chulal yulati gedor mabul, for we deserve extinction no less than the generation of the flood. Ki so ishis l'chibul v'nivul, the foe slurred God's throne with obscenities, bound in chains with the priests of the watch. V'yatzavakev kavul, kohen kavul. Again, it's playing on the name of the Mishmar. The Kohanim of Tzfat are destroyed. The Romans realized. Initially, they didn't go after the leadership, but when they saw that the people in Israel were not going to forget their traditions, the first thing they did was try to destroy the leadership. This kina is focused on that. There's an acknowledgement that we rebelled against God. The Kohanim from Nazareth. Again, this language from last night, from the keynote of last night. The kina ends with Tavo Tamriach v'chashvi tazriach. May the healing start. May the darkness end. And again, the Kadesha Atzmosenu Tafriach. This is that graffiti that is from Yeshayahu that I shared with you, that was found on the stone in the on the Kotel. Again, this was written Rabbi Lezer HaKalir. Perhaps the individual was familiar with this from reading this kina so many thousands of years ago, and when he visited the Western Wall, he needed to leave a remnant, and therefore he scratches in to the Kotel, the Kadesh Atzmosenu Tafriach, as I showed you earlier. Okay. Umishulchancha Tariach, Shulei Chamad Ariach. Before we go to the next kina, perhaps the most challenging of all, I'd like to give you a little bit of an archaeological background. It's critical in order to understand this kina. And really the depth of its pain. We're in source 15, which you should be able to, page 12, you should be able to see in front of you now. And again, it will take us a few minutes to explain this, I wanted to share with you, we're going to go to Kina, that is Kina 17. It speaks about the tragedy of the women and the fact that they suffered and were raped and were compromised in so many different ways. The biggest challenge is seeing their children die in front of them. And we're going to discuss this a little bit. And their children being hit, or their children being hidden. We're going to show some of the archaeology that's important to be able to understand this Kina 17. So it's going to take us a few minutes just to explain this Kina, and then we're going to read it together or read part of it together. You have in front of you the entrance. This is Robinson's Arch. What we just see now is simply this piece over here. It's the southwest corner. This, where my cursor is the west. This is the south, and you can see the remnant of the arch. This is how the Jewish people, for the most part, would enter into the temple. This was only one way. The major way they entered was from the southern wall, where my cursor is right now. That's where they normally entered, right in this area over here, the area that I'm highlighting. But this was also an entrance point into the temple. And when the British, and even in the time of the Turks, the times of the Turks where the British and others were discovering the area, there they found the right, They found right in this area over here, where we actually still see fallen stone. They found all of these fallen stones. And what they did was they removed the fallen stones. You can see the fallen stones even now. They drew pictures. You can see the fallen stones. These are the fallen stones from the top of the Temple Mount. These are the fallen stones from here, from over here. And you can see these fallen stones even still today, 2,000 years later, you can see these fallen stones. And if you look at the stones, you can see even on the stones, the charred, burnt of the stones. Well, anyways, as they were going through removing these stones, they found an area, a hole, and they went underneath the hole. And they found an area. And actually, they saw that one of the stones had cut through the pavement of the sidewalk. Warren. Sir Warren is actually recognizing this, what he found here. He doesn't really know much. It wasn't this whole area underneath the pavement was filled with debris and rubble. This area seemed to have been open where he was. And they draw a picture of what he saw. Many years later, when I say many years later, I mean most recently, what happened was that in the city of David, they discovered walkway. This walkway is actually important. It's a walkway that leads up to the Temple Mount, and it has Herodian stones. You can see the Herodian stones over here. However, this walkway, in order to be able to trace it all the way up, you would have to destroy homes. You're not going to destroy homes in the city of David. It will cause a world war. And it starts out, this walkway starts from over here, the pools of the Shiloach, and actually a mikveh that was used, one of the mikvehs that was used as the Jewish people would ascend to the temple. So they decided that since they couldn't continue to archaeologically trace this walkway, that they would look what's underneath the walkway and basically trace it not from above, but from below. And as they trace it from below, they realize that there is a sewer, that this was a sewer underneath the Kidron Valley, a sewer actually underneath the city of David. To be more precise, a sewer underneath the city of David. And this sewer underneath the city of David, actually goes from the city of David, which is the lower city, to the upper city, which is what we call now the Old City of Jerusalem, which is really the newest part of the Old City of Jerusalem. And it's a sewer system. And as they're walking through the sewer system and cleaning it out, they actually see something. They see this, which I'm highlighting here. They see this stone, the stone that broke through the sidewalk. And they are reminded of the fact that they remember this stone. They remember this stone from the excavations of Warren in the times of the Ottoman and British reign over Israel. And basically what they do is they go up, they break out of this sewer, and they land up over here, which is right in front of the Western Wall. So this sewer, they have it. You could actually, I don't know if during Corona, but you can actually go into it up to here. The sewer starts right in the lower city of Jerusalem, right over here, underneath here. The sewer starts right over here, underneath here. And it goes till here, but it actually continues, this sewer continues through all the way. It follows the direction of the Western Wall. And there are multiple sewers, and the Gemara speaks about these sewers that were paid for by the half shekel. All of the upkeep of the city was paid for by the half shekel. It was the chatzi shekel wasn't only there to support the temple, but it was also there to support the infrastructure of the old city, and that was one of the things. Now, what's so important about all of this? Obviously, at least for me, this is extremely interesting. But these sewers very much served a different role during the destruction of the Second Temple. And that is, they served the role of hiding Jews. And you actually find remnants of the sewer. You find this, which is a piece of gold. It could be that as the Jews were escaping out of the city of Jerusalem into the sewers, that actually would lead to the lower city and would actually allow them then to walk into the Judean desert and to Masada and to other places. They took some gold with them. You actually found a Roman sword with its leather sheath partly intact. This Roman sword is particularly from the legion that was sent by the emperor to destroy Jerusalem. Every legion had its own type of sword. And you actually also see graffiti on the walls of the sewer. Imagine a young kid or a teenager who has to stay in the sewer for days, if not weeks, like the hidden children during the time of the Holocaust. And he has nothing to do, or she has nothing to do, but she paints or etches within the stones a remembrance of the menorah. This is what's happening in the sewers. And Josephus, the person that we talked about a little bit earlier, Josephus, the traitor of the Jewish people, who becomes the writer of the Jewish people's history, one could argue maybe that's a redemptive component for Josephus. Josephus speaks about these sewers. So now let's look at the source here, source 18. So now, left these towers of themselves, or rather they were ejected out of them by God himself, and fled immediately to the valley which was under the Shiloah. That's where I showed you. That's the valley underneath the Shiloah is into the Judean desert, but he's also speaking about this area over here, which we found some of these remnants that I told you, where they gained, recovered themselves out of the dread they were in for a while, and ran violently against the part of the Roman wall which laid on that side. In other words, by going underneath, they actually were able to try to run away from the Romans who were destroying and murdering all the Jews. But as their courage was too much depressed to make their attacks with sufficient force, and their power was now broken with fear and affliction, they were repulsed by the guards, and dispersing themselves at distances from each other, they went into these subterranean caverns. So first they try to run away on top on the ground, and they can't. So now they run away into these subterranean caverns. And Josephus speaks about the fact that all of a sudden the Romans start to hear these Jews in these subterranean caverns. Others made a search for underground, and when they were found, they broke up the ground and they slew all they met with. In other words, the Romans, when they heard that these Jews were in the sewers, what they did was they took their swords and they started breaking the tops of the sewers. They started breaking the sidewalks. And actually, if you walk these subterranean sewers now and you look up, you actually can see the marks of the sword where the Romans were breaking to kill. They would break down and they would murder the mothers and the children and the fathers as they did this. So they would break in and then they would go down and murder them. And as it speaks, and while others were so greedy of the gain, they would go among the dead bodies and they would take anything they found, the gold or anything else that they found. There was other things they found. I didn't want to share with you everything they found or some. I just wanted to give you a point. So I'm highlighting again the fact that this area, these subterranean sewers that were found, these subterranean sewers that have now been rediscovered and have been cleaned out, and which we now have some of the remnants of them. The Roman sword with its leather sheath partly intact, the remnants of some of the, maybe the gold they were taking or some of the graffiti. This speaks to the next kina, the kina of the loss that happened to the women and to the families. Im techauna nashim piriyam olalei tibuchim. As I recall, again, Rabbi Elazar HaKalir, I've picked this year Rabbi Elazar HaKalir keynote, except for the next ones that we'll do that aren't. Im techauna nashim piriyam olalei tibuchim. As I recall, women eating their own fruit, their coddled babes, woe is to us. Compassionate women had to cook their own children once they were killed, once they were murdered, in order to have their other children stay alive. Or women who were murdered and killed when the braids of their hair were torn from them after being tied to racing horses. You read this paragraph, you know that this was written by Rabbi Elazar HaKalir, focusing on the destruction of the temples and of the Jewish people in the First and Second Commonwealth. But this is also what was done by the Nazis, Yimach Shemam, with Jews, that they would attach their hair to the bumpers of the cars, and then they would ride and they would murder them at that time. Im tidbak lashon yoneg lecheich. The tongues of infants were stuck to their palates, parched with thirst. B'tzibon sichichim ulalali, woe is to me. Of women who were wailing to each other, come let us cook our squealing children, woe is to me. What it means is we need to keep our children quiet or else they will rat out the rest of our children. Again, the challenge in the Holocaust where a child would be smothered by trying to keep him or her quiet in order to save the rest of the group. Tani b'nei, give me your child, the child hidden already, cut into sections, woe is to me. Intizameina b'sar avot l'banim b'maro sichim. Or the other way, or when children needed to eat and their parents had died, or children who encountered their parents' flesh in caves and pits. Condemned maidens who on their mother's laps were swollen with hunger. So it's speaking about the sewers. It's speaking about what happened to the Jews in these places. And the archaeology, as well as the language of Josephus, just shows us that this were not an exaggeration. This is exactly what was happening. It was exactly what was occurring. Women who were miscarried and couldn't feed, nurse their children anymore. And how the armies were totally decimated. It goes on. Goes on and says, "Im tzaparnal even achas," where I've highlighted, "tisha kabim ochei yodim menuchim." Again, the Jews, the haters of the Jews, haven't changed their tactics. This speaks about the fact that on stones, children's brains would be crushed, children's heads would be crushed. Exactly similar protocols, similar forms of masochism happened with the Nazis. "300 infants hung and strung on one long tree branch." Again, same thing that happened during the Holocaust. Except in the case of the Holocaust, the tragedy was even greater than it was in the destruction of the temple. Eish Kodesh, the Pizetzna Rav, writes about the fact that he's living through the Holocaust, and he said the Holocaust, all the keynote that he read, everything is happening during the Shoah, but it's even happening at a greater intensity, with even greater numbers. We now are going to actually focus on one or two other components that aren't found in the sources that I just want to pick up on. I mentioned to you the fact that the keynote focus on the whole notion of tragedy. So the keynote will focus on not just what happened during the temple period, which is what we've been focusing on, but it will focus on what happened during the Crusades, the first Crusade, where spire, worms, and mice are destroyed. That's Kina, for those who have a keynote book, 25. Mi yiten roshi mayim ve'ini mekor nozlai. That's an important Kina that focuses on the destruction that happened. It's where the prayer Avarachamim comes from. The prayer that we recite throughout the year is focusing on the story of the First Crusade. The First Crusade is the first time the Jewish people have to deal with what's called proactive martyrdom, or actually modeling after what happened with Josephus, or should have happened with Josephus, where Jews, based on the permission from the Balei HaTosfot, are actually committing murder in order not to be forced to be baptized, forced to become Christians. And this is the focus of the 25th keynote. The keynote continue on. There are other keynotes that speak about the losses. I want to then go back to what I said earlier about that the keynote have a different mindset than prayers in other locations. For example, there is a keynote that speaks about the Arzei HaLevanon. It speaks about the destruction of the 10 martyrs. And then I believe I mentioned the 10 martyrs that were murdered during the Hadrianic persecutions. In the keynote of this morning, we don't focus on why it happened. We don't focus on the whole notion of redemption, but rather we just focus on the tragedy. But if you read the keynote, or you read the story in the Yom Kippur experience, you will see in the Yom Kippur experience, we focus on the tragedy. That's Arzei HaLevanon. It's Kinah number 21, where we focus on those issues. And so there is a difference between the style of the keynote that are found in Tisha B'Av, and the keynote that are found, or the prayers that are found in other locations. And the perfect example is this Kinah, where it focuses on the Asari Ruge Malchus, but mentions nothing about why this tragedy happened. And if you read it on Yom Kippur, that's the focus, because on Yom Kippur, the focus is on tshuva, and here the focus is on the enormity of the challenge. I wanted to also take you into another kina. And this kina is about what happens with the burning of the Talmud in in Paris in 1242. This kina is not written by Rabbi Lezer HaKalir. It's written by the Maram of Wittenberg. In this kina, the Maram Wittenberg speaks about the 24 cartloads of books that were destroyed. Now, first of all, let's talk about this for a few minutes. First of all, what's so important about the fact that 24 cartloads of books of Talmuds are being destroyed? It's important for a few different reasons. First of all, it represents when you burn books, that's much more intense than just banning books. But the burning of these books are really manuscripts of the Talmud. This is before the printing press. And therefore, the Jewish people lost all different versions of the Talmud. We essentially have one Nusach left of the Talmud, but the other Nusachot, or the other manuscripts of the Talmud, we don't have. They were destroyed. Lost in this 24 large cartloads of books are also the works of many of the Rishonim, of the medieval commentators. This is a threat to the life sustenance of the Jewish people, the oral tradition, the Torah. And therefore, as important as it is to focus on the temple and the loss of the temple, it is also critically important to focus on these books that represent Kihim Chayenu V'Orech Yomenu. They represent our entire life, our entire essence. That's what they're all about. And therefore, we're focused on that also. And that's what this kina is all about. It's also critically important to recognize, I wanted to show you that in Paris, there's actually the location of these burning of these cartloads of Talmud. There's actually a sign that you can see in the ground there. I'm going to try to bring it up a little harder here, where it says, or it speaks about the destruction of the Talmud. And Shali Srufa Be'esh, it speaks about the fact that it's quoting the kina that we're going to read in a few moments, Shali Srufa Be'esh. It also is quoting the Gemara in Avodah Zarah on the top, which speaks about the fact that when the books are burnt and destroyed, while the parchment or the cloth might be destroyed, the otiot, the letters, continue to remain and go up to the heavens. A year or two ago, I had the privilege of spending time with my colleagues from Baron Amiel and Strauss Amiel, and we were teaching our rabbinic shlichim, our men and women who serve as educators throughout Europe, and we were in Venice. And in Venice, which is where the first printing press started to print the Talmud, in Venice, after the 2.5 days or so of classes that we gave with the men and women who are unbelievable shlichim for the Jewish community all over Europe. Again, we're privileged to have 277 of them at the current time. I stayed an extra half a day to spend some time in the Venice library. They have a library. And unfortunately, the library isn't visited much. I would encourage all of you who go to Venice to go to the Jewish Museum there to see if you can ask the librarian to go see some of these books that I'm just going to talk about now for a few minutes. These books also, like the Rambam and the Talmud, the books that I saw and I was able to touch and hold, are from before the printing press. They're from the same time that these books were burnt. And actually, what you actually see in these Svarim of the Rambam and of the Gemara, you actually see a Christian censor who went through them. You see like a marker that he crosses it out with a marker, different parts of the Talmud or different parts of Maimonides, which he thought was questionable. For example, the piece of Maimonides that talks about the notion of Messiah thought was questionable regarding Jesus, or the comments that there might be about the need for the Mashiach to be alive in order to play the role of the Mashiach. And those pieces are removed from the Talmud or crossed out in the Talmud. And you see at the end of these books, you see actually they give it their sign of approval, their seal of approval, that they censored it properly. This is at a time before books were printed. This is not like we had the Koran printing press that is always printing new Sfarim for us. This is a time in which every book had to be handwritten. The destruction of 24 cartloads of books is extremely significant and extremely challenging. And the person who writes this Kina is the Maharam Rutenberg, who lived in this area and knew what was going on. And he speaks about it so someone was raising their hand. O'Brien was saying that you can visit Yodafat in the Galilee area. The ruins are still available, are still visible. Thank you, Brian. Yes, that's 100% true. You might have said this a long time ago. I'm just looking at it now. Yes, you did say it a long time ago. But I just want to point out to you I didn't show that picture because it's not clear whether that is from the time of the destruction of the temple or post-temple period. So for intellectual honesty, I didn't want to show that. But I appreciate it. I would encourage people to go to Arbel and Yodafat and to see those things. I would definitely encourage it. There's so much to see there. One other thing, as we're talking about that, and we'll get back to this, Brian. If you look, we spoke about the Kohanim of Tzipori. Tzipori is a Jewish community that is not destroyed during the Second Temple period. Other leadership communities are destroyed, but Tzipori is not. And Tzipori, it would make sense for Tzipori to be destroyed. It's on the nexus of a group of highways. It's at a transportation artery. Why isn't Tzipori destroyed? And you actually can see that the people of Tzipori figured out a way to work hand in hand with Romans. They actually make a statement to the Romans that they are no longer going to focus as Jerusalem as the center of their lives. They do something very drastic. If someone knows what that is, very drastic, you can share it with me. You can share it with me in the chat. But I don't want to take up our time together by just waiting. But it's a critical thing that they do. And I would encourage you to go to Tzipori, and you will see that Tzipori is one of the only shuls that does not face towards Jerusalem. It faces away from Jerusalem. It's a statement that they make, that basically they're saying, and they made a deal with the Romans, we want to continue to live as Jews, but we will be servants, and we will not create trouble. And therefore, they develop their synagogue away from Jerusalem. It's not facing Jerusalem. It's not facing what we call East. It's facing away. A comment that they're not connected to Jerusalem. It's different than Yodafat and the Galil and the Golan, where they make coins that say Laman Yerushalayim for Jerusalem. They're actually doing the opposite here. They're saying that we are doing something as a way of not being connected to Jerusalem. We don't want to be connected to Jerusalem. We want to sustain and guarantee the future of the Jewish people. We will be focused on the oral tradition and on Jewish continuity, and we'll give up Jerusalem in order to be able to do that. And I encourage anyone who goes to Tzipori, It's normally not highlighted by tour guides, but just look at the location of the synagogue there, and simply take out from your phone where Yerushalayim would be positioned, and you'll see that we're in the exact opposite location. The Maram in Wittenberg, in speaking about the tragedy of what happens, in an introduction to one of his responsa about the burning of the 24 cartloads of the Talmud and of rabbinic literature that was lost to all of us, says the following: Azal ruchi v'tashkochi, my spirit and my soul, v'or einai, and the light of my eyes, ein iti machmas hamatzik asher gavra yado aleinu. It's no longer with me. I've lost my spirit. I've lost my soul. I've lost the light in my eyes. They're not with me anymore. Asher gavra yado aleinu, because of what's happened to us, that we have been overcome by enemies, by the Catholic Church that has decided and has insisted that after a set of disputations that the Talmud needs to be destroyed. Asher gavra yado aleinu b'maod v'nefesh machmad einenu lakach v'ein b'yadenu sefer laskil ulavin shadai yikanei la'amo v'yomar l'tzaratenu dai. I don't have my sperm anymore. So much has been destroyed, so much has been burned, so much has been compromised. The envy of Daniel Sefer last skill, I don't have my books to look at anymore. Ulavin, and to understand. Shaddai Yikaneh, God, you should have mercy on us. You should be jealous for us. Ulamo, and for the Jewish people. V'yomar l'tzaratenu, and say to our enemies, die, that this is enough. And then he answers the halachic question that he's given. Aodot b'chor me-Rutenberg, asher kidash betulah yedei shliach. A case of a young man from Rutenberg who wishes to marry a woman and does so through a shliach, through an emissary. Whatever the question is, not as important. But he introduces it because of what happens in 1242 with the burning of the 24 cartloads of Talmud. Now, I think the most important piece of this is, why does this happen? Now, the obvious reason of why it happens, the historic reason why it happens, is the fact that the books are burned by the Catholic Church, and that would be enough to create this kina. But it's more than that. It's much more than that. You see, in this exact location, years earlier, the Maimonides, the works of the Rambam, were burned. The Rambam, who many Ashkenazic Jews, especially in France, created a whole campaign against them. The Rambam, who actually is put in cherem by these rabbis, by Rabbeinu Yonah and by others. The Rambam's books are not just banned, they're burnt in France. And therefore, the rabbis say, or some of the rabbis say, that you know why the Talmud is burnt by the Gentiles? Because the Jews give the Gentiles permission, and the Jews themselves burn the books of Maimonides. And when Jews burn other Jews' books, when rabbis are so willing to speak out against others and burning their material, then what happens is eventually, then it's not just Jews who burn Jews' books, it's also non-Jews who start burning Jewish books. We have to remember that Sinat Chinam doesn't just cause the destruction of the Beis HaMikdash. Sinat Chinam causes destruction throughout the history of the Jewish people. And we are experiencing Sinat Chinam in our day and age also. We're experiencing the fact that leaders can get up. As leaders got up and attacked the Rambam and put the Rambam in cherem, there is a folklore, or maybe it's true, that Rabbeinu Yonah, who was one of the people who did this, wrote the book Shari Tshuva, wrote a book of repentance because of how he treated Maimonides. These were great rabbis. that sometimes lost their way in the way they treated other rabbis and other people. And that's sometimes the challenge, and we see that here also. When a great rabbi can get up and simply attack other Jews, even Jews who are not following the tradition, that puts us all at risk. The Netziv, Rav Naftali Tzvi Yehuda Berlin, makes an unbelievable statement that I'm going to pull off my bookshelf for a second that I want to read for you. So I'll move away from the screen for 1 second, but I need to read this to you. The Netziv, in his introduction to Sefer Bereishit, explains why is Sefer Bereishit known as Sefer HaYashar? Why is this book known as by the rabbis as the straight book? And the Netziv explains that the reason why this is known as the straight Sefer HaYashar is because the strength of the patriarchs are the way they deal with other people. And it speaks about the fact that God wants their leaders to be Yashar, Tzadik v'Yasharhu, he quotes from Ha'azinu. The Shvach Yasharhu Ne'emar L'Tzadik, the greatness has to be, or Tzadik v'Yasharhu, the Shvach Yashar, Hu Ne'emar L'Tzadik Din HaKadosh Baruch Hu B'Chorban Bayisheni. The destruction of the Second Temple is not because the Jewish people didn't keep Trumot HaMasrot. That is the destruction of the first temple, and that's a limited destruction. It only happens for a short period of time. The larger destruction, says the Netziv, is because of the fact that that Shahayu Tzadikim v'chassidim v'omlei Torah, I'm reading word from word from Naftali Tzvi Yehuda Berlin's introduction to Sefer Bereishis, that there were tzadikim, chassidim, righteous and pious, and people who studied all day. Ach lo hayu yisharim b'halichot olamin. They weren't yashar, they weren't accurate, they weren't fair, they weren't nice to the way they treated others. In Cain, mivnei sinat chimam shalibi bilibam. It's because the hatred that it was in their heart, ze ze al ze, one to another. Chashdu edmi shera'u shenoheg shelo kedatam b'yirat Hashem. They saw people that didn't follow their ways in fearing God. Shehut stuki v'apikores, that they're stukim v'apikores. You have a great rabbi of our generation who on the 17th day of Tammuz got up and said, you can't say amen to the brachot of conservative and reformed Jews. He didn't even say that just about their rabbis. He said, you can't say amen to their brachot. Even if reformed and conservative Jews don't celebrate the Masorah like we wish that it would be celebrated, to suggest that we can't say amen to their brachot. That's what it's talking about here. Uba'u aidei zeh, and because of this lack of respect, aidei shvich adamin b'derech haflaga l'chor ra'ot b'shot ba'olam, this causes the shvich adamim, this causes the challenges, this causes the destruction, ad shecharav habayis, and this is what caused the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash. Af agav shehu l'shem shamayim, even though they did this, they spoke out against other Jews, l'shem shemayim, tzeh goreim churban habriyah shalom. That's what causes the churban. And so the Netziv says the reason why Bereishit is called the book of Yashar is because the avot were not just tzadikim in the way they dealt with God, they were tzadikim in the way they dealt with others. Even idol worshippers, they dealt with respect. That's the clear piece. That's what's clearly important. This is so important. This kina, it speaks about the burning of the 24 cartloads of the Talmud. It puts the future of the Jewish tradition at risk. But the greater issue and the greater challenge here, which is what some of the rabbis write about, is the fact that this burning was because rabbis didn't just ban the Rambam's books. They burnt the Rambam's books. It's why the Maharam in Wittenberg says, as I read, the fact that he can no longer go on. He's so troubled by the fact that our tradition is now being challenged because we've lost our books. We've lost the ability to continue the conversation. That's what this kina is about. Let's read it together. Shalis rufa be'esh. It's Kina 41. Shalish shufa be'esh lishlom evelayech. Inquire, consumed in fire, after the well-being of your mourners, who so strongly desire to reside in your dwellings. Hamim v'shom k'vachatz v'leich ha-shofim ba'afar ha-aretz v'kovim ha-mishtomim alei mokei gilayech. Who are pained and shocked by the destruction of so many of the scrolls. They walk in darkness. And this is the Maharam in Wittenberg. He's the same great rabbi that I shared with you, his responsa. It's really his words. They walk in darkness, unillumined, but the hope for the light of the day to shine upon them and upon you, and inquire too of the welfare of that sighing man crying with a broken heart, constantly bemoaning your pangs of torment, who wails like jackals and ostriches and calls for a bitter eulogy on your behalf. This is also very critical. Here, Maharam in Wittenberg picks up on something that is important, and that is the diaspora is not just a diaspora for the Jewish people. The galut is also a galut for God, that God imposes upon himself a diaspora experience. It's called Shchinta Begaluta, that God is in galut, that there's two components of God. There's the feminine component of God, known as Shchina, and the masculine component of God, known as a Kadosh Baruch Hu, or Kidshu Brihu. And the fact is that when the Jewish people are in galut, the Gemara Megillah tells us that a piece of God goes into galut with the Jewish people. The Midrash tells us that during the first temple period, when they walked in to the Holy of Holies, they saw the kruvin, the cherubs that represent God and the Jewish people. They saw them in an embrace. And all of the commentators say, how could that be? We're told that when the Jewish people and God are not getting along, the cherubs look away from each other. But yet here we're seeing the fact that the cherubs are not just looking at each other. They're embracing each other as the temple was being destroyed. And there are two answers that are given. One answer that is given by the Kabbalists is the fact that before a parent and a child leave each other, they hug. And before the Kruvim representing God and the Jewish people are going to leave each other, they hug. But another, the commentaries explain, there are two paradigms to God. There's the Shechina, there's the feminine and the masculine, and the Kudsha Brich Hu. The peace that's hugging the Jewish people is the peace of God that is going into mourning with God, with the Jewish people, that's going into galut with God. That's what's happening. It's Kudsha, it's the Shechinta that's in galuta, it's the Shechina that's going into galut. That's what's happening. And that's the focus here. It's the calls of the bitter eulogy on your behalf. God, we're not just asking for our redemption. We're also asking for your redemption. You need to be redeemed also. There's a piece of you, God, that also goes through, that also is in the state. And by the way, that's what the prayers of Shabbos are all about. Shabbat focuses on Me'in Olam Haba. It's a quasi look into a time in which there'll be the redemption. And therefore, on Friday night, when we speak about God, we speak about God in the feminine. We speak about God as the Yanuchu Va Yisrael Mekadshim Shemecha. We speak about God in the feminine. Shabbos morning, we speak about God in the masculine. V'yanuchu Vo. We speak about God in the masculine. And then in Mincha time, we speak about Ata Echad V'Shimcha Echad. God, there will come a time in which your name will be one, in which the Jewish people will be whole again. And that's what this Kina is speaking about, that calls for a bitter eulogy on your behalf, God, that we're basically, we recognize, and throughout the keynote, there is this idea. there is this recognition about that it's not just us that are suffering, it's you, God, that's also suffering. You know, the truth is that Eshet Chayil, I hope I don't get in any trouble by saying this, we speak about it, and it should be spoken to our spouses who give up so much to allow us to actualize our potential, and they play roles outside the home and roles inside the home, as hopefully we do also. But also Eshet Chayil is really speaking to the two components of God, the feminine and the masculine components of God. Some have the custom before they make a bracha to say these words, l'shem, before they do a mitzvah, l'shem yichud kucho brichu shchinte, in order to guarantee the unity of God, of kucho brichu, of the masculine component of God, shchinte, and the feminine component of God, I'm going to recite this bracha to help me get to a point in which I bring the redemption to the world through the mitzvot. There is a wholeness that is achieved in God, not just a wholeness that's achieved in the Jewish people. We go on with this kina. Hochim chashikim ve'ein noga, v'kogvim l'or yomam. Second paragraph. Echa natuna be'esh ochla tukal be'esh basar v'lo nechvu zarim v'gachalich. How can that which was given a divine consuming fire, the Torah, how can the Torah, the Talmud, which is for all eternity, be consumed by a fire kindled by mortars? And how can those intruders not be scorched by your ambers? Until when will Rome dwell in great tranquility while the faces of my flowers are covered by thorns? How long will you sit in arrogance judging the sons of God with such harsh judgments and presenting them to your tribunals? This is talking about all of the disputations that happened and the decrees to burn the fiery law and the statues of Torah and Talmud. Happy is he who will repay in kind. We go on. Did my protector present you in the presence of torches and fire so that at your end you would be sent on fire from below? And it goes on and speaks about all of what's happening here and the responsibilities, a comparison to a king who cried at his son's wedding feast knowing that his son would die. Is that what you stand for? Instead, a noble gown, Sinai, cover yourself in a garment of sackcloth, wear a widow's clothes, change your dress, Sinai, look what's happened to your what you gave us. The Talmud has been destroyed. Yagiu kivroch neis sare atzilayach Moshe v'Aaron b'hor ha'hor. And we should speak to Moshe and Aaron and ask them, how could this have happened to the Torah? How can the scrolls, the oral tradition, be destroyed? And this is really the focus of this paragraph, of this kina. I find it pleasing to fetch all my tears until they are gone for all those who cling to the hem of your robes. God, we're holding on to you. This is what's happening here. Again, you hear these same words that the Maharam of Rittenberg used in his introduction to his response literature in here also. Sa'aki b'kol mar letzur, cry in a bitter voice to your rock, to God, for what's happened here. But at the end of the day, we also have to realize that the beginning of the banning and burning of Jewish books didn't happen by Gentiles in France. It happened by Jews. Otadi ba'adi shinai, v'tof tichi tochi v'chov v'tzali b'machayach, yarum l'vavi be'esuri l'or lach, And he will illuminate your darkness and dispel your gloom, that they will again come and come to the end of the process. We're going to actually now conclude with Elitzion, which is Kina 45, those who have it. And this Kina really speaks about all of the different components of the destruction. It's really normally recited, it's really the final Kina written by Yehuda Halevi. It focuses on all components. So we're going to try to attempt to sing it. I don't have anywhere near a good voice. So we'll just spend a little time together. And I'll just annotate it as we go through it. Again, it's the final kina of the day. Eli tzion v'yareha, kemo isha v'vzireha, v'chib tzula chagura tzak, al ba'al ne'ureha, ale harmon asher nutaz, ba'ash matzon adareha, v'al v'yad mechorfei el, v'toch midash chadareha, ale galut mishorete el, ani meshir zimareha, ba'al dama mashir shufach, kemo mimei ya'oreha. So the first part is speaking about the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, the destruction of, it's like a woman who is feeling the pain, or a man that's feeling the pain of the loss. We then continue at the destruction of the temple to focusing on the loss of the leadership, the Ale Galut Meshur Te'el, the Kohanim and the Levi'im, Mani Meir Zmarel, who sang the songs, and their blood has been spilled. It's as large as a pool of a river. Ale Hegeon Mecholeha, Asher Damam Be'areha, V'al Va'ad Asher Samein, U'bitul Sanhedreha. The songs that would come out of the temple, or the songs that come out of the cities, the songs that would come out of the Sanhedrin, and here the song is the responsibilities of justice that happened to the Jewish people. The fact that in the Beit HaMikdash, it wasn't just a place of prayer or sacrifice. It was a place of learning of Talmud Torah. It was a place that dealt with life cycle events. It was a place that dealt with charity. It was a place that dealt with social justice. Alei zivchei tami meda, tami deha, upidjonei b'choreha, v'al chilul kaleihecho, mizbach g'toreha. Destruction of all of the various kalim, of the vessels of the Beit HaMikdash, some that is said are still found in the Vatican. Alei tapei milacheha, v'nei David gevireha, v'al yafam asher chashach, Be'esaru kitareha, the leadership and the families of the leaders that were totally destroyed. Ale kavod asher gala. This is the point I was saying to you. The most important piece of this is, God, what about your respect that was destroyed? Be'et chorban devireha, your destruction with the destruction of the temple. It's not about the stones. It's about the fact that, God, you live with a chasm. A self-imposed chasm, a chasm. Alei kavod asher galad, you're in galut, God. Asher lachatz v'shat v'sam sakim chagureha. Alei machatz v'ro makod. Asher huku nizireha v'al nifutz alei selah olalau neara. The children that were destroyed by their heads being smashed against stones. Alei simchat oiveha. The joy that your enemies have. Sachku al shivraha, who are so joyous about the destruction that happened. Ba'al inui b'nei chorim, ni divah tahoreha. Alei pesha asher ifta, salul derech ashurreha, ve'al tzivot kehalaha, shizuvah shachorreha. And the loss of our freedom, the fact that we're no longer free. Alei kalod mechorafeha, and the enemies who are joyous. Be'ez ribui pegareha, when so many have been murdered, as I shared with you, even in the subterranean caverns, even in the sewers. Va'al rikshat megadefa betok mishkan chetzereha, and their joy in the temple with its destruction. Alei shimcha asher chulal, and your name that has been also profaned. B'fi kamay mitzireha, the altachan yevatz chulach, kishov ushma amara. Listen to our prayers. Eli tzion v'areha, g'mo isha b'tzireha. We're crying to you. We're screaming like a woman who is in pain. U'kibtula chagur atzak, and like a young maiden who was married and lost her husband immediately and is wearing sackcloth. We are the same way in our relationship with you, God. And we hope that this will be the last year in which we'll have to commemorate this loss. God, we hope that this will end. We hope that this will stop. We hope that we'll be able to end this tragedy. But we also have to be reminded, and with this we'll conclude, we also be reminded that we're responsible, as we began with, the tone of Eicha and the tone of the trup, the cantillations of Eicha and Megillat Esther are the same. It's just the tone that from our voice, from our throat, it's our throat, it's our actions that define whether this is Eicha or Megillat Esther. It's really just up to us. It's the difference between Galut and Geula, between Geula and Gola, between redemption and exile is the Aleph and Ani. We make that difference. We define how we can build and add one more stone to the redemption and the rebuilding of the Beit HaMikdash. That's up to us. And please, God, we will take Tisha B'Av seriously, because the biggest responsibility of Tisha B'Av happens the day after, when we have to engage in the world again and ask ourselves, as the Netziv says, it's not enough just to be observant in connection with God. It's about how we engage and talk about others. It's the responsibility that we have to be able to make a difference. And please, God, when we do that next year, it will be a joyous day. Rabbi Soloveitchik explained how he remembers as a boy that no one ever bought hard-covered keynote, because why would you buy a hard-covered keynote if by next year you won't need it? Because it's over. You know, they would put it in the Geniza. They would bury it after Tisha B'Av because we won't need it next year. You know, we buy leather-bound keynote. But we need to change that in our own hearts, at least. And we have to make sure that we are totally focused on bringing redemption, because while God is ultimately the orchestrator of the redemptive process, he needs us as his partners, and we make the difference through our actions. Have a rest of the meaningful fast, and may we be zoche to having days of redemption in the future. Thank you.